Hey everyone, and welcome back. You know, let's face it, dating these days is kind of like navigating a maze, right? Whether you're all about those dating apps or just kind of watching everyone else do their thing.
Definitely a jungle out there.
It really is. So we found this article, and the title really caught our eye. It's called, Does Online Dating Suck? Or Is It Us? What are you hoping to find?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question to think about.
I thought so too.
Yeah.
And it gets you thinking beyond, you know, just swiping left or right and really digging into, like, what are we actually looking for in a partner?
Right. It makes you think about the deeper stuff.
Yeah. And sometimes I catch myself getting so caught up in the, oh, he's cute or her bio's hilarious, that I forget to ask the important questions, like, would this person actually fit into my life?
Yeah.
You know? The article talks about this idea of defining your dating intentions, and not just in a vague, someone who's nice way.
Right. It's like getting really specific about those non-negotiables.
Exactly.
Like those things you absolutely have to have.
Yeah. What are those must-haves?
Yeah. The author actually gives a personal example. They want someone who also has kids.
Okay. So that's practical. Makes sense.
Right. That's a practical consideration. But then they also mention wanting a badass.
Okay. So that's a little more like aspirational.
Exactly. It's that extra something special.
I love that. It's like, yeah, I need someone who can handle the school pickup line, but also someone who's going to, you know, challenge and excite me.
Mm.
Speaking of excitement, the article talks about this really cool thing called this rainy Saturday test.
Yeah. This is where it gets fun.
Oh, I like where this is going.
So picture this. It's a rainy Saturday afternoon. You're with your ideal partner. What are you doing?
Ooh, I like this already.
Right. Are you curled up with a good book? Maybe tackling a home improvement project together? Or even learning a new dance routine?
Okay, now you're talking.
The author's list is a mix of everything. Snuggling by the fireplace, hiking in the woods, even jetting off to ski in the Alps.
Okay, maybe skiing in the Alps is a little bit aspirational for a rainy Saturday, but I get the point.
It's about painting that picture.
Yeah, not just kind or funny, but would we actually enjoy hanging out together, rain or shine? Would we have that spark?
Exactly. It's about imagining those shared experiences.
So, like, if my rainy Saturday list involves us cooking an elaborate meal together, that might say I value someone who's collaborative and enjoys those shared experiences.
Right. Or maybe your rainy Saturday involves hitting up a new museum exhibit.
Which means I'm probably drawn to someone who's intellectually curious.
Exactly. It's a really fun way to uncover what you're truly looking for in a relationship.
Like a vision board, but for your love life. And then it gets even more interesting with this idea of an aspirational partner list.
Dream big.
I'm all about that.
The author even jokes about their aspirational partner being a millionaire tennis-playing woman who's into yoga and tantric sex practices.
Okay, so maybe not all the boxes need to be checked.
It's more like using it as a guide.
A thermometer for compatibility. I like that.
Yeah.
So if my list says passionate about environmental activism, and I meet someone who volunteers at the animal shelter...
Hey, that's a pretty good sign.
Right. Even if they haven't quite made it to Greenpeace yet.
It's about recognizing those core values and passions that resonate with you, even if they show up in slightly different ways.
Totally. It's that, hey, we're on the same wavelength feeling.
Exactly. But, you know, we can't just live in a fantasy world of millionaire yogis and alpine adventures. At some point, we got to talk about the things that make us go, nope, not for me.
The deal breakers.
Yeah.
And you're right, those are super important to figure out early on.
Yeah, the author's example, not wanting a partner who dislikes sex, might be a bit too much information for some.
It's getting personal.
But it highlights how deal breakers are different for everyone and often tied to our core values.
Totally. So, like, if one of your core values is honesty and your potential partner has a history of, shall we say, bending the truth.
Yeah, that's a pretty clear sign to proceed with caution.
Red flag alert.
And sometimes these deal breakers, they come from past experiences.
Oh, for sure.
Like if you've been with someone who is constantly critical, you might be really sensitive to negativity or judgment in the future.
Makes sense. Recognizing those patterns can be so helpful. Okay, so we've talked about knowing what you want and do what you don't want. But then there's the whole question of where and how we find these amazing people.
Right. Where do we even begin?
Exactly.
And that brings us to online dating. It's a bit of a mixed bag.
Oh, tell me about it.
The article acknowledges it can be a great way to meet people you'd never cross paths with otherwise.
I mean, it definitely expands your options, right?
It does.
There's always a but.
Sometimes it feels like we're spending more time crafting the perfect witty bio than actually going out and having those experiences.
Isn't that the laziness the article title hinted at?
It could be.
Right.
That ease of just swiping can sometimes make us passive about dating.
It's so easy to get caught up in judging people based on a few photos and some carefully chosen words.
Yeah, and while a good profile pic is important, it doesn't tell you if someone snorts when they laugh or can hold a conversation about something other than the weather.
Right. It's like judging a book by its cover.
Exactly. You might end up with something beautiful on the outside, but totally boring on the inside. And this goes for to our Rainy Saturday test. If you're dreaming of someone who loves rock climbing with their kids, are you out there doing that yourself?
Ooh, that's a good point. It's like putting it out there to the universe. Hey, I'm over here living my best life. Come join me.
Exactly. The article really emphasizes that finding a partner means putting yourself out there, engaging with your passions, being proactive, not passive in your search.
Okay, so step one, ditch the dating app for a day and hit the rock climbing gym.
Or join a book club volunteer at a soup kitchen. Sign up for that salsa class you've been thinking about. It's about aligning your actions with what you want, creating opportunities for those serendipitous connections.
And who knows, you might even meet someone amazing while belaying them down a mountain. But what if you find someone who checks all those boxes, but you don't necessarily share every single hobby? Is it a deal breaker?
Not at all. The author talks about dating a marathon runner.
Uh-huh.
And while they weren't a runner themselves, they were drawn to her passion and found ways to support her, like biking alongside her during training.
So it's not always about having identical interests. Sometimes it's about finding ways to support each other's passions.
Exactly. Think about past relationships where there are hobbies you didn't share but found ways to support.
Oh, interesting.
Maybe your partner was a musician and you helped them set up for gigs or even learn to appreciate their music.
Sometimes that kind of support can mean even more than sharing the hobby itself.
It's about showing up for each other even when it's outside our comfort zones.
I like that. And that brings us to another important point the author makes. Being ready for a relationship.
Yes, the inner work.
Right. We can have all the lists and strategies in the world, but if we're not in the right headspace,
yeah.
Well, it's like trying to bake a cake without flour.
Exactly. You need the right ingredients.
It's just not going to work.
The author talks about moving on from past hurt, being empowered in your life, cultivating self-worth. It's about doing that inner work so you can enter a relationship from a place of strength, not neediness.
And this goes back to our aspirational partner list, right?
Mm.
If you're not showing up as your best self, how can you expect to attract someone who embodies those qualities?
It's about aligning your inner world with what you want on the outside.
Like that saying, be the change you want to see in the world, but for your love life. And speaking of powerful statements, I think this line from the article sums it all up. You must never feel like you are settling.
That's where it all comes together.
Right.
Defining what you want, visualizing your ideal relationship, being empowered in yourself, it all sets the stage for attracting a partner who truly aligns with what you're looking for.
Someone who makes you feel like you're expanding, not shrinking.
Exactly. Someone who celebrates you, challenges you, inspires you to be your best.
I love that. And I think that's a great place to pause for now. We've covered so much in this first part of our deep dive. But don't worry, we'll be back with part two, where we'll be exploring.
The whole idea of compromise in relationships.
Oh, yeah. That's a big one.
Because, let's be honest, nobody's perfectly aligned on everything, right?
That's for sure. But how do we know when it's healthy compromise and when we're giving up too much of ourselves?
That's the question, isn't it? And the article doesn't really give a straight answer.
Okay.
But there are some hints. Remember that aspirational partner list we talked about?
Yeah.
It's not just about finding someone who's like your dream come true.
Right.
It's also about figuring out your core values, those non-negotiables.
So if one of my core values is living a healthy lifestyle, and my partner's someone who like lives on pizza and energy drinks,
that might be a sign you're not a good fit in the long run.
Probably not going to work out long term.
Exactly. Right. But that doesn't mean you have to have every single hobby in common.
Yeah.
It's about finding someone who respects your values, even if they don't fully share them.
So maybe they're not hitting the gym with me every day, but they're cool with whipping up a healthy meal after work.
Exactly. It's about finding a partner who compliments you rather than contradicts you. And this goes back to being strong and independent in your own life.
Because when you're secure in who you are and what you want, you're less likely to compromise on those things that really matter to you.
Exactly. You're not looking for someone to complete. You're looking for someone to share the journey with.
I like that.
And that journey, it's going to have bumps in the road, disagreements, compromises.
That makes a lot of sense.
Yeah.
But where do we actually find these aspirational, non-settling, supportive partners? Mm-hmm. Is it online dating? Or are we better off meeting people IRL?
That is the million-dollar question. And the article kind of dances around it a bit.
Yeah.
You know, it says there's no one right answer for everyone.
Okay, fair enough.
But the author does mention that online dating gave them a sense of hope, especially after a breakup.
I can see that. Sometimes just knowing there are other single people out there can be a real boost, especially when you're feeling down.
Exactly. It can be a way to dip your toes back into the dating pool.
Yeah.
Start exploring what's out there.
Test the waters.
Right. But like we talked about before, that whole swiping thing can be a trap too. It's easy to get caught up in the superficial stuff, judging people based on a carefully crafted online persona.
It's like we're all trying to sell ourselves instead of just being ourselves. And sometimes I think we miss out on those real, genuine connections that happen naturally in real life.
You're right. And that's why the author's advice to go where your potential partners are is so important.
Okay, I'm listening.
It's about putting yourself in environments where you're likely to meet people who share your interests, your values.
Okay, I'm game, but honestly, where do I even start? Should I be hanging out outside, climbing gyms or something?
Well, maybe not hanging outside, but you're on the right track. Think about your rainy Saturday test. What activities were on your list? If you picture yourself hiking with your ideal partner, maybe join a hiking group. If you're dreaming of someone who loves live music, check out some local concerts.
It's about putting your actions where your heart is.
Exactly.
If you want a partner who's passionate about art, immerse yourself in the art world. Galleries, pottery classes, volunteer at a museum. You're not only increasing your chances of meeting someone like-minded, but you're also enriching your own life.
Exactly. And, you know, it's not just about where you're looking, it's also about how you're looking.
Oh, what do you mean?
Are you open-hearted, positive? Or are you carrying baggage from past relationships that's weighing you down?
Ooh, that's a good point. Mm-hmm. It's like trying to attract butterflies with a net. Sometimes we need to loosen our grip and just be open to possibilities.
Precisely. Because even if you're doing all the right things, defining your intentions, putting yourself out there, if you're not emotionally available, it's hard to build a real connection. It's like trying to build a house on a foundation of sand.
It's just not going to be stable.
Yeah.
Okay, so emotional readiness is key.
Right.
But what about practical readiness? Finances, career, living situation. Do I need like a 5-year plan before I even think about dating?
While the article doesn't get into those specifics, I think having some stability in your life can definitely make for a healthier relationship. It's not about having everything perfectly figured out, but about having a sense of direction.
So maybe not a 5-year plan, but at least knowing what city I want to live in and if I'm cool with dating someone who has 17 cats.
Exactly. It's about knowing yourself and being honest about your needs and expectations. And it's about creating a life that feels good on its own, so you're not coming into a relationship from a place of desperation.
You're not looking to be rescued, you're looking for a partner in crime.
And adventures are always more fun when you're both prepared, right?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
But let's be real, even when we're emotionally ready, financially stable, and putting ourselves out there, dating can still be tough.
No, it can be brutal out there.
Ghosting bad dates, mismatched expectations. It's enough to make you want to swear off dating forever.
And that's where the author's message of never settling is so important. It's like our shield protecting us from settling for less than we deserve. But it's also a reminder to keep reaching for those stars even when we stumble.
I love that analogy. It's about believing that a fulfilling, amazing relationship is possible. And trusting that by doing the work, both on ourselves and in the world, we'll get there eventually. But that brings up another question. How do we know when we've found the one? Is it a feeling, a checklist, a sign from the universe?
That's a question people have been asking forever, and I don't think there's a simple answer. Maybe it's a little bit of all those things, a feeling, a sense that this person feels like home.
But maybe that's part of the beauty of it all, the mystery, the journey of discovery.
Perhaps. And maybe, just maybe, the answer isn't about finding the one, but about becoming the one ourselves.
Whoa, okay, hold on, that's deep. So if we want to attract an amazing partner, we need to become the most amazing versions of ourselves.
It's a pretty powerful idea. Because when we're living up to our potential, when we're being authentic and confident, we naturally attract people who are drawn to that energy.
It's like we become magnets for the kind of love we want to experience.
Yeah.
Okay. I need a minute to process that one. We've covered so much today, from compromise to becoming the best versions of ourselves, but don't worry, there's more to come. In the final part of our deep dive, we'll be exploring the whole timing thing in relationships.
Ah, yes, timing.
It's like, even when you've done all the right things, you know, like figured out what you want, worked on yourself, put yourself out there. Sometimes it just comes down to timing, right?
It really does. It's this element we can't quite control, but understanding it can make all the difference.
And the article touches on this, especially in the context of being ready for a relationship. The author talks about not dwelling on past relationships, letting go of anger, being strong and independent.
It's about reaching that point where you're not carrying baggage or looking for someone to complete you. It's about being ready to share your already full life with someone special.
So timing is about being internally aligned, like being in the right headspace for love when it comes along, rather than forcing it or settling because you're lonely.
Exactly. And it's also about realizing that everyone has their own timeline. There's no magic age for finding love, no set schedule. Comparing ourselves to others or feeling pressure just adds stress.
It's like trying to force a flower to bloom before it's ready.
Exactly.
It'll just wither. But what about the timing of actually meeting someone? Is it fate? Or just being in the right place at the right time? Like, should I start carrying a lucky rabbit's foot or something?
Maybe a little bit of both. There's definitely an element of chance, those random encounters that turn into something special. You know those rom-com moments where people bump into each other at the coffee shop or strike up a conversation on a plane?
Yeah, those meant-to-be moments that make you believe in a little bit of magic. Mm-hmm. But those chance encounters are more likely to happen if we're actually out there living our lives right.
Exactly. Remember what we talked about. Putting yourself out there, aligning your actions with your desires, that's how you create those opportunities.
So it's not about sitting at home wishing for Prince Charming to magically appear. It's about creating a life that's so amazing that love can't help but be drawn to it.
Right, and when those moments happen, it's about being open to them, trusting your gut and taking a chance. Sometimes love shows up when you least expect it, and if you're not paying attention, you might just miss it.
Like they say, you miss 100% of the shots you don't take. Except in this case, the shot might be a smile across a crowded room or an invitation for coffee.
Exactly. So be present, be open, and trust that the universe has a plan, even if it's not always on our schedule.
Wow. We've covered a lot of ground in this deep dive. From creating our rainy Saturday test list to becoming the best versions of ourselves and trusting in divine timing, it feels like we just got a masterclass in love and relationships.
And I think the biggest takeaway is that finding love isn't a spectator sport. It takes effort, intention, and a willingness to put ourselves out there, both emotionally and physically.
It's about being active participants in our own love stories, not just waiting for someone else to write them for us. And while we can't control every little thing, we can definitely steer the ship in the right direction.
Well said. And I think that's a perfect place to wrap things up.
So as you continue on your own journey, dear listener, remember these insights. Figure out what you want. Picture your dream relationship become the most amazing version of yourself, and trust that the timing will work out.
And most importantly, never settle for a love that feels anything less than extraordinary.
And that's a wrap for our deep dive into modern dating. We hope you learned a thing or two and feel inspired to approach your own love journey with purpose, clarity, and a whole lot of heart. Until next time, may your love lives be filled with joy, adventure, and of course, perfect timing.